When hard times hit, it can bring out the good in people.
I've never seen a response like the response we've been getting from all over the place about baby Fiona.
An acquaintance of the victim set up a GoFundMe campaign.
We helped them when they came to us. We have benevolence.
But it can also bring out the ugly.
We have seen nothing that's indicated this child's had cancer or ever had cancer.
The Jamaica Plain woman is accused of faking her injuries to steal almost $40,000 in benefits and cash.
What kind of person takes advantage of that?
A pretty big lowlife.
Because there's so much interest in Fiona, obviously some people are trying to capitalize on it.
In January of 2017, Fiona, a baby hippopotamus, is born 6 weeks premature. This little survivor causes quite the stir around the Cincinnati Zoo.
Everyone is excited about the baby hippo. There's even a Twitter feed that opened up raising money.
She only weighs a fraction of what she will, but the popularity of baby Fiona,
I mean, people are in love with this little baby hippo,
is not to be taken lightly.
I'll tell you what, I've never seen a response like the response we've been getting from all over the place about baby Fiona. I think part of that is that she is a preemie and she still isn't even as big as she would have been when she was born if she was normal size.
An online campaign begins selling shirts to help pay for Fiona's costly care while she's still in the ICU. So sweet. And who wouldn't want a cute hippo shirt?
It's hard not to love a little baby hippo that's in need of help. People want to give. Hi, my name is Cheryl Bader, and I'm a former assistant U.S. attorney, and now I'm teaching a criminal defense clinic at Fordham University School of Law.
But buyer beware.
There's a hefty concern about some social media sites claiming to raise money for Fiona, like this one. It says proceeds from Link to provide vital medical care, selling shirts for $25.
The problem is, that feed has no connection to the zoo whatsoever.
Scammers take advantage of the fact that this is going to be an easy target for raising money.
Some might be well-intentioned and really do want to support the zoo.
And there's no way to know if these sites are people who would actually give the money to the zoo or just keep it.
If you get approached by GoFundMe through a message like, hi, my name is Sue and I'm fundraising for, you can write to GoFundMe and say, listen, I got approached by this person. I don't know this person. I don't know the family. GoFundMe will investigate it.
My name is Dr. Catherine Lavery from Pace University, the Criminal Justice and Security Department. I have done a lot of research on fundraising and charity scams.
Again, if you want to donate, the only way to make sure that your money goes to the zoo is to go to the zoo's website and donate there.
Sound advice. Donating elsewhere could result in feeding a different kind of animal.
It's very hard to accuse somebody of fraud if it appears that the victim is willingly giving them money or ongoing funding.
This scam is about fundraising for oneself. Several years ago, a Pennsylvania fellow devises a tricky plan. He meets a woman online. It's love at first profile pic. He involves her in his entrepreneurial efforts to flip cars and convinces her he's a romantic catch, which makes selling her on his plan to flip cars that much easier. She gives him $8,000 to buy two Audis that he plans to sell for a higher price.
Then she paid $2,400 for repairs for those Audis and her own car. Also in July, she paid him more than $8,000 to buy a car for her mother.
We think everything is secure because we have an expectation that it is, and it really isn't.
Days turn to weeks, turn to months, and the woman is not seeing any returns on her investment.
None of those cars or repairs were real.
The gentleman says he's bought more cars, all while depositing a fraudulent check in her account.
Often in these scams, you'll see a buildup of trust, and often the perpetrator will even put money in the victim's account and then will withdraw that money so that there's a track record of the perpetrator being good for the money. Then the next time, they'll put money into the account, but the check will actually bounce.
2 days later, she withdrew the money at this bank. The check bounced, and the bank began their investigation.
From there, the case goes to state police, who interview the woman and put two and two together.
Investigators allege he scammed a woman he met on a dating website and her mother out of more than $19,000 over several months.
The fellow eventually pleaded guilty to theft.
I would just be careful of anyone that gets involved in any type of relationship whenever somebody is quickly moving into the financial aspect where they need help, they need this, they need that, and they're promising you the world. Generally, those things end up being scammed.
The issue is if you've known somebody for 4 or 5 months and all of a sudden you're turning over $10,000 because, oh, by the way, he claims to be a financial investment banker, you need to get the credentials and you need to monitor the person and you want to ask them, let me see what you've done with people's money. They should be able to prove that if they're real.
Up next, a mother claims her family has been hit by a financial hardship when her daughter allegedly receives a terrible diagnosis.
When you are piggybacking on somebody who's been victimized or a family or a child who's sick or anything like that, you're tugging at heartstrings.
She has told the other siblings and the father that the child has cancer and the child's not going to live.
For the people of northwestern Oklahoma, it's a heart-wrenching story. In need of money for her ill daughter, Jessica Lynn Good rallies support from her church and community.
Good spent years telling people her daughter had cancer and other illnesses. They raised thousands of dollars for her youngest daughter.
When you are piggybacking on somebody who's been victimized or a family or a child who's sick or anything like that, you're tugging at heartstrings. You know, it is natural in our society for people to want to help, to make a contribution.
We helped them when they came to us. We have benevolence.
She asks her fellow church members for support, and they readily step in to help.
The good campaigns are, my child is very sick and we have costs of over $30,000 for this. We need to put the child in a special hospital and we need to cover hotel rooms for the family because it's out of state. The more detailed they are and the more directed they are where the money's going to is actually better for the people donating.
Pastor Eric Keller said church members became suspicious of Jessica Good's fundraising. The latest plot involved a trip to Chicago for special treatment.
The mother goes to Chicago, but it's not for her child's treatment.
We believe she had other reasons for going to Chicago.
Records indicate she intended to go meet an NFL football player.
It's hard to have any sympathy for this woman because she used her child in order to get this money.
Through medical records that we're able to obtain, we have seen nothing that's indicated this child's had cancer or ever had cancer.
Links on her Twitter account to get money for treatment in Chicago have been deleted.
Eventually, Good pleads guilty to 3 counts of fraud.
I don't know why somebody would use their daughter in this situation. This department takes it at heart pretty much because we know there are people out there that need this.
The other thing is that it really has an impact on her faith community. You know, here they are, they open their arms to her, they open their pocketbooks to her, and to be betrayed like that, it's really a shame.
Keller hopes those swindled will find forgiveness.
What kind of person takes advantage of that?
A pretty big lowlife.
Holidays are right around the corner. Rows of brand new toys, a chance for the less fortunate to have a Merry Christmas. For years, the Marine Corps has sponsored this local Toys for Tots program.
We are still accepting donations, cash or toys. All they gotta do is come by, walk in the door, and help us out.
One problem. This year, there's a Grinch getting in the way of Paul Caputo and the Marine Corps' good deeds.
Last December, a fake GoFundMe account was set up using the event's name and shared online.
We do not use Facebook. Okay, we do not use GoFundMe accounts. It had all our logos.
Would-be scammers set up fake social media accounts to look just like the charity, attempting to intercept funds that would go for these Toys for Tots.
If we did a page, if we hired somebody to do a page, we would have wanted it to be this way.
He did this page in such a professional manner, you would think that someone in the Marine Corps designed it.
So in many of these cases, there is evidence that the scammer has nothing to do with sending money to any of these organizations and is just pocketing that money. And you can, you know, follow that money trail and see that they're not actually donating any of this money. They often don't have permission from the families or others to misappropriate the names.
I mean, imagine it's December 26th and your kids are still staring out the window waiting for Santa Claus.
Fortunately, the fake page was shut down immediately. Even better, no one fell for the scam.
Toys for Tots wants you to be on the lookout and not get conned by someone who appears to be trying to steal Christmas.
GoFundMe, for example, has built-in protections now because of examples of fraud that they've seen.
I got blown up and I have medical records that prove this.
It's feeding into a narcissism or possibly a character disorder.
Fight or flight. In April 2013, as people flee the terrifying scene of the Boston Marathon bombing, Joanna Lee risks her life by running toward the attacks to help. Or so she says.
She's kneeling on the ground, speaking with a man injured by the explosions. Lee has billed herself as a hero, claiming she ran toward the scene and was hit by the second blast.
Lee says she's just 10 feet away from the second bomb as it explodes, knocking her unconscious, leaving her with traumatic injuries to her brain, affecting her hearing and vision.
I was injured.
Lee's road to recovery is long and so difficult that she seeks the help of a four-legged friend.
That was Lee thanking volunteers who helped search for her donated service dog.
I knew Joanna before the marathon bombings and after, and there was just a huge difference that there's clearly a traumatic injury. She's not been the same at all.
Lee thanked the kind-hearted people who've helped her.
Perfect strangers come together to do such a kind, kind act.
Lee isn't just given a new companion. She also receives financial assistance with the help of crowdfunding.
Court records show Lee received $8,000 from the One Fund, $9,000 from a GoFundMe account, and nearly $2,000 was raised for her by children at the Mildred Avenue Middle School. She's also having her bathroom renovated, compliments of the Boston Survivors Accessibility Alliance.
As Lee continues her very public and heroic recovery, her story reaches more and more people, including reporters at WCVB.
Investigators say Lee was actually several blocks from the bombs, not running into the chaos like she's claimed.
The only known image of Joanna Lee on the day of the Boston Marathon bombing.
The photo shows Lee here at the intersection of Fairfield and Newbury Streets. It's a block away from the marathon route on Boylston Street and another half a block away from where the second bomb detonated at the Forum restaurant.
Her alleged heroism is indeed life-altering in more ways than one. Physically, mentally, and potentially criminally.
Lee's first floor neighbor says she is suffering from injuries and doesn't believe the charges.
But take a close look at the picture. Her clothes appear to be clean, not a scratch on her leather jacket, not a hair out of place.
Lee heads to court to set the record straight in 2015.
Lee appeared to need help walking, but our cameras caught her moving around just fine in the weeks leading up to her arraignment. And we discovered another questionable photo on her Facebook page with Joanna Lee holding what she described as images of her injured brain, listing her as the patient, but someone else's date of birth. She was born in 1974.
In March of 2015, almost 2 years after the tragedy, electrician Dave Braga is at her door ready to donate his time to renovate her bathroom.
I didn't even know till just minutes ago.
Braga is caught off guard when he learns of the allegations.
Not good. Not good. Especially when you gotta pay for everything, all the material and the labor.
Five investigates discovered contractors designed and installed a $30,000 bathroom in Lee's house, the labor and materials donated.
A short time later, Braga's told by his boss that his work here is done.
I'm not even sure what we're supposed to do now.
When people hear about these scams, they're going to be reluctant to open their pocketbook the next time. So these charity frauds, you really hurt the most vulnerable, needy people.
Prosecutors say Lee was getting support she didn't deserve.
I don't go to doctor's appointments every day and have given up my whole life because this is an enjoyable life for me.
Lee ended up collecting $38,500 from several funds intended for victims, even publicly insisting she was owed more.
So, are Joanna's pleas to the public genuine? Or is it all a facade?
This is like a witch hunt, and it's just, I think it's cruel.
Alleged Boston Marathon scammer Joanna Lee heads to court.
The Jamaica Plain woman is accused of being a fraud, faking her injuries to steal almost $40,000 in benefits and cash meant for victims of the bombing. In this application for more benefits, Lee asked for shelving, organization systems, an iPad, and a meditation room. That application was denied.
That's horrible. It's horrible. That money is meant for people who need that money. She shouldn't be taking it.
Scammers make it very compelling, and they understand both technology and psychology and how to play upon your sympathies.
This is like a witch hunt, and it's just, I think it's cruel.
She even showed up at her arraignment limping. Today, no visible traces of injury.
Can you explain why you did it?
Her attorney claims Lee did suffer PTSD as a result of being there and helping victims, but admits she's got problems.
By 2015, her lies unraveled. Lee admits to the wrongdoing and pleads guilty to all charges.
We didn't have a lot of extra cash, and we were kind of depending on that to pay for the funeral costs.
In 2017, 23-year-old Sabrina Galusha was stabbed to death. An acquaintance jumps into action to help the grieving family, or so he says.
Concord police say Jeffrey Grenier, an acquaintance of the victim, set up a GoFundMe campaign entitled Sabrina Galusha Funeral Fund. The campaign stated the money raised would go to Sabrina's family to help them cover funeral expenses. The victim's father says as much as $5,000 was raised.
Yet, Sabrina Galusha's grieving family is struggling to pay for her funeral costs.
Police say Grenier told the Galusha family the funds would be transferred to them. But by the end of June, they had not received any money.
Friends and family and people that we know had donated to that. I mean, we had relatives in Maryland and Florida and everything donated to that.
Sabrina's father says they had no reason not to trust Grenier.
We didn't have a lot of extra cash. And we were kind of depending on that to pay for the funeral costs.
The money didn't help pay for the funeral, not even a hearse. But when police investigators visit Concord, they discover that Grenier did pay for a car with the money, a car for himself.
I mean, you know, first with Sabrina, now this. I mean, come on.
This is a really sad case because it's re-traumatizing this family and putting them through grief again. And so for somebody to actually take advantage and, find something that happened in the news and say, this is how I can profit on this, is really a sad commentary.
My wife and I, we looked at each other and we said, what the hell did we ever do to deserve this?
It's not unusual for a scammer to be watching the headlines and see a crisis and want to capitalize on that.
Grenier pleads guilty to felony theft, and at his sentencing says that he made a bad decision.
He said after he was charged, he made a bad decision. It's interesting that all during the fundraising and when he went to go purchase the car, it wasn't a bad decision.
When that money got into my client's bank account, that's when he made a terrible mistake, a terrible lapse of judgment, something that he has regretted every day since and no doubt will continue to regret.
I just want to give my sincere apology to the family. I didn't mean to end up this way.
With a lot of scammers, they get, you know, a little bit remorseful or appear remorseful because they actually got caught.
Deception was unexcusable. I mean, you know, we tried to work very kindly with this gentleman, and he just kind of lied to us all the way through.
Sabrina's family satisfied that Grenier will now spend 9 months in jail.
I'm just hoping that today, hopefully, some justice is served properly, just given the circumstances.
Luckily, we worked for a great company, and our boss didn't think twice about paying off the funeral. So we're working now to pay her back.
You know, I look at internet scam artists very similar to the general violent criminals. There are a myriad of reasons why people commit violent crime. There are a myriad of reasons why people commit online scams.
These days, swindlers will go to great lengths to take advantage of people and baby hippos in vulnerable situations.
Anybody who takes advantage of another person's illness or another person's crime, it's pretty jarring. It's not right. It's criminal.
I'll steal it!
How do we find the honorable in a sea of sketchy scammers?
Many people will notice when they donate to GoFundMe, they have to pay almost a 3% interest. And then you're also going to notice there's an additional charge of 30 cents on each donation. Believe it or not, that actually goes to a victim's fund. And GoFundMe actually has 25% of their entire staff that work on what they call trust and safety issues with campaigning.
So good people, keep giving, but keep your eyes open.